then we can start.
Dr. Uday will be doing the thing. And who is presenting today? I mean, who will be the...
Mihir and Ashish. These are the two they are going to answer. Am I right, Prashant? Mihir and Ashish?
Yes, sir. Dr. Mihir and Dr. Ashish.
Uday ko please co-host bana do.
Yes, sir. Dr. Uday is already co-host.
Already he's co-host.
So, Dr. Uday...
I'm ready.
Now you share your screen then. And then whatever case presentation chalu karte.
Hey, what do you do, everyone? Can you make it full screen?
So, good evening, everyone. I welcome you all for the today's clinic for PG updates. So started with Dr. Gaurang Shah and Dr. Venkat Gite. So I invite all the eminent faculties, Dr. Gaurang Shah, Dr. Venkat Gite, Dr. Ganesh Bakshi, Dr. Hiren Soda, Dr. Pankaj Maheshwari, and a special speaker today, Dr. Aparna Kadgare. So I'll start with the case history. He's a 25 years old male, resident of Lower Parel, Mumbai. Engineer by occupation, he presented to OPD with the chief complaints of palpitations, sweating and vomiting since 3 to 4 months.
Okay. Mihir, these are the main primary symptoms. Now looking at this, what are the differential diagnoses comes to your mind and how you are going to ask the questions?
With the chief complaints, I want to ask some more details about his complaints, like whether he had got a fever or he had got symptoms related to urinary tract infection, or whether he had any past history related to cardiac diseases or with the complaints, sir, probable differential diagnosis difficult with this complaint, sir, but patient with the 3-4 months of this history and with the young age, it could be the secondary hypertension could be because of adrenal cause, maybe because of adrenal pheochromocytoma.
Yes, Ashish, what are your differential diagnoses looking at this? What comes in your mind?
Based on these symptoms only, we can look for pathology regarding adrenal, pathology related to cardiac disease, as well as pathology related to renal region.
Very good. What else?
I would like
very
to
young guy.
Further elaborate with these symptoms, and I would like to ask some negative history also for this.
Yeah, that is true. But what are the things come? Can it be because of anxiety also?
Anxiety neurosis can cause this kind of symptoms.
Can it be because of hyperthyroidism?
Thyrotoxicosis, thyroid-related diseases can also lead to this kind of symptoms.
But male patient with the...
Why because of renal?
Renal hypertension, there may be symptoms of, sir, palpitation and sweating.
Okay.
Fine. So these are your main differential diagnosis. You will keep it in mind, and depending on that, you will ask the history. Correct. So you can tell us what are the positive, negative history you want to know. First of all, will you like to ask about palpitation, sweating, and vomiting? What you want to know?
whether this palpitation, sweating, which were continuous throughout the 3 to 4 months, or they were paroxysmal, means there were episodes of palpitation, sweating and vomiting, or they were persistent. That I want to ask. And whether they occur due to any exaggerated activity or any kind of anxiety, that I want to ask further related to the symptoms.
Okay. So if it is because of cardiac, what are the important things you want to know? Palpitation, along with that, breathlessness, breathlessness, yes, on exertion, orthopnea,
or swelling over the lower end.
Yeah, if it is because of thyroid, what are the things you will like to ask? Whether patient has, along with that,
in thyroid,
increase appetite.
Yes.
Weight loss.
Yes.
Increase in anxiety, increase in appetite, weight loss, along with changes in the eye if it is thyrotoxicosis is there.
Fine. Okay. So what else you want to know? Just tell him so he'll go ahead. Anything else you want to ask?
Other than this, sir, I would like to know the negative history for this patient, whether there are any abdominal, any kind of abdominal pain, flank pain is there or not. Any abdominal swelling, any history of constipation, any history of lower urinary tract symptoms, any history of sir weight loss, loss of appetite, bone pain, or any history of cough, hemoptysis, breathlessness, any history of trauma, the back, any history of allergy, and to rule out the negative history in the form of diabetes mellitus, hypertension, and if the hypertension is there, how many medications he's been taking, and whether it is controlled with that medications or not. And
okay, Dr. Gite, you want to ask anything?
No, sir.
So we'll go ahead. Ganesh, anything we'll you want to ahead. Add on to this?
We'll go ahead.
Okay. Okay, go ahead.
I will continue his history of present illness. He was apparently all right with 3 months back. So all of a sudden, he developed with palpitations, so which were episodic, insidious in onset, and progressed usually over the time. And it usually occurs during and after meals, and it lasted for at least 5 to 10 minutes. So for which he has consulted the he had one exacerbation of palpitation episode, so he consulted the physician and it was treated symptomatically. Then later on, he presented with vomiting and increased sweating along with palpitation. So vomiting was insidious and it gradually progressed. It was not associated with any nausea. There were no precipitating factors, and vomiters generally contained of food particles. So for this, patient got admitted and evaluated for the same. So these are his negative history. There is no history of anxiety or any panic attacks, no history of chest pain, syncope, no history of abdominal pain, no history of lump in abdomen, no history of bowel symptoms like diarrhea, constipation, no history of weight loss or any cold preference or tremors, no history of hematuria, stone disease, or no history of skin lesions.
Okay, so history is over here.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, Meer and Ashish.
Any additional?
Yeah. Meer, Ashish.
Any additional history you want?
So no lower urinary tract symptoms.
Right. Or no lower urinary tract symptoms associated with all these things. Palpitation, sweating. That can happen before a micturition syncope.
And why it happens?
Sir, in micturition syncope, when patient passes urine, that leads to stimulation of sir vagus system, and that leads to hypotension, and ultimately patient develops syncope.
Why in this case you want to ask?
The patient
what
has
is the relationship?
History of sir sweating and palpitation, we have a differential diagnosis of pheochromocytoma. So in paraprostatic paraganglioma, it can happen, sir.
So it can be in the bladder.
It can be in the bladder.
That is what Dr. Ganesh Bakshi wanted.
Hmm. Yeah.
Right. Anything okay. else you want to add, Ganesh?
Sir, we'll move on to past history.
Yeah. Past history.
So for past history, for this symptoms, whether he has taking any antihypertensives and.
As of now, there are no history of diabetes mellitus, hypertension, tuberculosis, any contact with tuberculosis patient. So no history of major surgery in the past. So coming to the personal history, sleep, appetite, bowel, and bladder habits were normal. He was taking normal medicine, and there was no history of any addiction.
What was the drugs prescribed by that physician during the first OPD visit?
He was prescribed with beta blockers and the palpitation settled down. So he was just treated symptomatically and was sent home.
Okay.
Again, because of the aggravated symptoms and nausea, vomiting, he got admitted.
Mihir, just out of context, what is the importance of PB in cases of adrenal tumors?
TB, it can cause adrenal insufficiency. It's one of the major cause in developing countries. Can cause lead to Addison's disease also.
Okay, good. And what is the relation of family history?
If family history, similar kind of family history is present, we could make out the pathology related to adrenal gland, because it can be presented in family members. It is hereditary also with pheochromocytoma, or it can be related to adrenal malignancy also.
What are the syndromes related to that?
Syndromes are related with that is VHL diseases, then sir neurofibromatosis, then MEN2A and 2B, and SDH B and D.
Can you elaborate?
That is paraganglioma.
Can you elaborate it? What are the association?
So von Hippel-Lindau syndrome.
Okay.
Then neurofibromatosis. Then
yeah,
multiple endocrine neoplasia.
What do you get in VHL?
Sir, in VHL, you will have retinal angioplastoma,
RCC with
then RCC, sir, cerebellar hemangioblastomas.
Pancreatic
and retinal angiomas can happen.
Okay, one person answer at a time. Okay, Ashish, if you are answering, you answer. Then what about men? 2A and 2B.
MEN2A and 2B, we can look for thyroid, whether there are any medullary thyroid carcinoma is there or not. And sir, rest I don't recall at present, sir.
So hyperparathyroidism.
So I will tell medullary carcinoma thyroid,
yes.
Hyperparathyroidism, and 50% PO. MEN2B, 50% again PO, usually bilateral. Mucosal neuroma and Marfanoid habit. Again in VHL, retinoblastoma, cerebellar hemangioma, nephroma, RCC, renal and pancreatic cyst.
Yeah. Thank you. Yes. Go ahead.
Coming to the general examination, so patient was examined in sitting position with implied informed consent. Patient was conscious, cooperative, averagely built, His temperature was normal with respiratory rate of 18 breaths per minute. Blood pressure was taken in supine position. In supine position, blood pressure was 124 by 78 mmHg with pulse rate of 100 per minute. On standing position, the pulse rate was 110 per minute with the blood pressure of 120 by 74 mmHg. So no supraclavicular lymphadenopathy. No, on thyroid examination, no nodule failed. No history of clubbing, cyanosis, icterus, lymphadenopathy, pallor or pallor. On genital examination, it was normal. For rectal examination, prostate was normal, flat. 82 examination was absolutely normal. So coming to the systemic.
Why do we want BP in two positions?
Sir, orthostatic hypotension sometimes can happen in case of he is on beta blocker. And orthostatic hypotension can happen in adrenal pathologies.
Okay.
So we change the position and check the blood pressures.
Okay.
So which are the conditions of adrenal you'll get a hypertension?
Sir, in pheochromocytoma, then hypercortisolism.
Aldosteronism.
So and in aldosteronism, primary aldosteronism.
Aldosteronism, you get hypertension.
Sir, in aldosteronism, there is increase in the aldosterone level, leads to sodium and water retention. That ultimately leads to volume in increase. That leads to hypertension.
Yeah, because it acts as a distal tubule and it retains sodium and with that. So what else happens with that?
Along with, sir, hypokalemia happens because potassium is getting excreted.
Yeah. Okay. Fine. Go ahead.
For abdominal examination, inspection was normal. No scar, sinuses, shape was normal. On palpation, abdomen was soft, non-tender. No renal angle tenderness. No organomegaly. Kidney non-valid. So RS, CVS, and CNS was normal.
Okay.
So I think that finishes the examination.
Yeah. So Mir, Ashish.
Ashish, you want to summarize or something?
Yes, sir.
Anything else, Sudhir? That's it, right?
That's it on general examination.
Yes, okay. So that's it.
So where do we go forward?
So we'll go forward with the investigation by keeping all this differential diagnosis same, sir.
Okay.
Sir, on investigation, I would like to have CBC, serum creatinine with electrolytes, along with, sir, urine routine and urine culture. Plus, I would like to have an USG KUB, abdomen KUB, and, sir, one ECG and 2D co for this patient, sir.
CBC, RFT.
CBC, RFT, and, sir, USG KUB. ECG 2D echo.
So one question is, why did you ask for urine culture?
Sir, if there is urine infection is there along with that, so we can treat the patient with that and then proceed forward.
Why you are expected urine infection?
Suddenly, why are you bringing, I don't know, non-specific thing?
To complete my sir, investigation from the urological point of view.
No. That is not done.
Okay.
To complete the investigation, you can tell n number of investigations. Urine culture is a specific investigation. Until and other, there is multiple questions in urine routine or clinical symptomatology. There is no role of doing urine culture primary.
Absolutely. So Uday, you can tell him some investigations which he wanted.
1 minute, Ganesh.
Yes, sir.
And Dr. Gite also. And Maheshwari also. In such case, in the exam, they should restrict only to like a routine, or because it is, we are suspecting hypertension and differential diagnosis. So at one stage only, we can ask about other investigation or later on.
So, sir, at the end of examination, if there is a one or two diagnosis in his mind, to confirm that diagnosis, he has to divide investigation into the baseline investigation and diagnostic investigation. In best to start with, he has to tell baseline investigation. And as an extension of baseline investigation, it has to tell second time the diagnostic investigation. So urine culture is a specific investigation. Until the Nadraj is suspecting any infection inside, then only he can tell culture as a patient.
Huh. So in this case, if they are suspecting either maybe thyroid or maybe cardiac or maybe, for example, adrenal, so that investigation they should ask now or later on?
Culture.
Culture,
you are asking about culture, sir?
Pardon? You are asking about culture, I mean? No, not culture. About any thyroid or any adrenal investigation should be asked at this level or later on?
Patient presented with palpitation and vomiting and he is expecting some pathology inside the adrenal. So he can tell, he can ask primarily one sonography, complete blood count, one urine routine, one CBC and one serum creatinine and one ultrasound. If there is any clue inside the ultrasound of the adrenal pathology, then he can ask parallelly all adrenal investigation.
Okay. Fine.
So adrenal investigation, as Gite sir is saying, matlab, the specific adrenal ones for functionality or anything should go after some finding is there in at the adrenal in either sonography or CT, whatever we ask for.
Yes.
Okay. So these investigations are given to you. HB12.4, creatinine 1, sodium good.
The routine microscopy is normal.
Yeah.
Sugar looks like RBS is normal.
His ECG was done. His ECG was suggestive of sinus tachycardia.
Oh, yeah.
Apart from no need of the change.
So Mihir, what do you want ahead?
Sir, I want to do one abdominal ultrasound. Ultrasound abdomen and pelvis.
Any images? Right, we have or whatever.
Yeah, the ultrasonography, the films and
ultrasound abdomen and pelvis was done. So, no abnormality was detected in any other organ apart from there was a 5 by 6 centimeter suprarenal mass.
Side?
Right. Left side.
Okay.
I want to do a functional evaluation related to adrenal mass, means adrenal pathology, as it is 6 by 5 centimeter.
What you want to do?
Related to his symptomatology, I would like to do for plasma metanephrine first. Low dose dexamethasone suppress and test with cortisol level. And salivary, midnight salivary cortisol level. I would rather repeat this 2 times if it is inequivocal.
I will ask one simple question. In how many patients you have seen a midnight salivary level in liver center?
No.
Then why you are telling? Because this is the practical example. What is done? Dekho. If the examiner asks like this, you have to think parallel. You have to ask for again CT scan because ultrasonography is not sufficient. Yes. That is one way. Another way, you have to go for anatomical investigation. You have to go for functional investigation. Functional investigation, what you are expecting inside is first 6 centimeter mass with hypertension, palpitation, hypertension. Hai nahi hai?
Nahi hai, sir. So nahi. We want to ask for mineral corticoids, sir.
Then you no need to do a mineral corticoid. So why there is a palpitation? What is the reason for palpitation and what is the reason for vomiting? Palpitation is due to the epinephrine and vomiting is due to the dopamine, due to vasodilatation of gastrointestinal tract.
Yes.
So dopamine and epinephrine, where it is secreted from, it is again secreted from it. So we have to think in this way and ask the investigation as per.
So, sir, we would like to have a sir's contrast and on CT scan with delayed films. And
telling the functional investigation first is also not wrong.
Okay, sir. And along with that, sir, in the form of functional, sir, investigation, I would like to have a plasma-free metanephrine and, sir, cortisol level. If cortisols are high, then we will do the low-dose dexamethasone suppression test. And yes, sir, this much.
And for hyperaldosteronism, what you will do?
Sir, we will do aldosterone renin ratio and a plasma concentration of aldosterone.
So, if same question asked to me in exam,
if there is hypertension,
can be serum cortisol, plasma metanephrine, and serum potassium already done, serum aldosterone. ये तीन baseline investigation करूँगा. इसमें से मुझे कुछ clue मिला और नहीं मिला तो उसके हिसाब से आगे decide करूँगा. So then the examiner may ask you, why not VMA, old people are doing VMA, what is the normal range of VMA, what are the precautions to be taken while doing the VMA, and why not catecholamine, metanephrine only, why not, why metanephrine and non-metanephrine, this is the sensitivity level, this is the patient, specificity, sensitivity, catecholamine, how much is metanephrine, how much is both, how much is VMA, how much is VMA, ये हर चीज पूछी जा
सकती
है. प्लाज्मा मिहिर
बोलो मुझे प्लाज्मा फ्री मेटानेफ्रिन का क्या सेंसिटिविटी
है? इट इज सर 99% सेंसिटिविटी.
एग्रीड. एंड स्पेसिफिसिटी?
इट्स सर 90%.
ओके, सो दैट इज करेक्ट सर.
ओके, आशीष, हाउ विल यू कलेक्ट प्लाज्मा फ्री मेटानेफ्रिन एंड नॉन मेटानेफ्रिन?
Sir, plasma-free metanephrines, when we collect, the patient should be nil by mouth for at least 12 hours. He should avoid smoking and taking coffee also. He should stop paracetamol for at least 5 days. And he should stop, if he was on SSRI or tricyclic antidepressant, he must stop that. And on the collection day, sir, patient is kept in supine position for at least 20 minutes. And if then we can take the sample, sir. And we can this much, sir.
This patient is on tricyclic antidepressant. Patient is on antipsychotic drug. Patient is on L-DOPA for Parkinsonism. Patient is on phenoxybenzamine. Patient had a habit of taking the caffeine and nicotine. Patient is on acetaminophen. ये सब चीजें बंद करना है.
Yes,
sir.
देखो पीओ में एक तो सर्जिकल पार्ट पे थोड़ा सा डिस्कशन चलता है लास्ट में. मेजोरिटी थिंग ये हाइपरटेंशन और ये सिम्टम्स में आधा हवा खत्म हो जाता
है.
इसमें कोई गड़बड़ नहीं चाहिए. आई टेने को
आई थिंक ही आंसर्ड एवरीथिंग बट ऑलमोस्ट. सो कॉफी वगैरह चॉकलेट्स इज वन मोर थिंग व्हिच जनरली पीपल वुड.
Yes, sir.
What is that?
Chocolate, sir.
Okay.
Foods that increase the catecholamine level.
Yeah.
Coffee, so,
anything else you ask in these investigations?
No, sir. I wanted to ask one thing to you, Mihir or Ashish. Like, yes, since we are on this, how valid is doing a urine VMA today?
Hello, sir, it is urine concentration of sir metanephrine. It is not routinely being done because it cumbersome. It requires 24-hour urine collection. No binding factors are not, but it gives a clear sensitivity.
Is very high.
Sensitivity is high, sir.
Yeah. So one more thing is, could you very shortly tell the catecholamine pathway?
Yes, sir. From sir phenylalanine, by phenylalanine hydroxylase, it converts into sir tyrosine, and from tyrosine hydroxylase it converts into L-DOPA, and from L-DOPA it L-DOPA to say it converts into dopamine, from dopamine to norepinephrine, and from norepinephrine to epinephrine by PNMT. And these are getting metabolized in the adrenal by COMT, epinephrine to normetanephrine, and epinephrine to metanephrine.
Right.
So, but current endocrinological guideline ke hisab se, doing only plasma free metaneprin is sufficient to diagnose the PO.
Right.
Because it has a maximum sensitivity and maximum specificity. As far as urinary catecholamine for metaneprin is concerned, specificity is more. Urinary metaneprin specificity is more than the plasma free metaneprin, but sensitivity is less.
Okay. Fine. So anything else now, Manish, you want, or we should go ahead?
I think we should go ahead.
Okay. So now what next?
Sir, we would like to have
coming
some
to the finance.
Yes, sir. After functional workup, sir, I would like to have a contrast enhanced CT scan with delayed image along with sir chest CT cut.
Functional workup, would I mention?
Sir, no.
Coming to the functional workup, so patient's plasma blood was withdrawn when patient is lying down in a supine position for 30 minutes. The value of plasma-free metanephrin was 2,221. Plasma-free non-metanephrin was 20.5. And 24 hours urinary VMA was 25.
So what now? How do you explain that?
Non-metanephrin level is quite high, suggestive of, sir, pheochromocytoma.
Adrenal or extra,
and it is sir mainly maybe due to extra adrenal also to look for that, because metanephrine levels are normal. Plasma free metanephrine levels are normal, so maybe due to extra adrenal etiology can happen, but sir, we would like to have an radiological investigation for that.
Plasma free metanephrine is normal?
Yes, sir.
How much is there? 2,221. Normetanephrine.
Is normal? Sir, normetanephrine is elevated, sir.
Huh.
Metanephrine is normal.
Metanephrine is normal. Okay. So what will be the diagnosis? If normetanephrine is elevated.
Sir, extra adrenal pheochromocytoma is one diagnosis, one adrenal pheochromocytoma and one extra adrenal pheochromocytoma. Okay. I would like to have, sir, CCT with delayed images and chest CT.
Okay. So, sir, should we ask Dr. Aparna to do the presentation?
Yes, yes.
Before, yes. We can also utilize the words and whatever she teaches in the further presentation.
Yes, sir.
So,
can
you stop sharing? Then I think
sure.
We will listen to the good lecture of Dr. Aparna and then we'll continue with us.
Yes.
Can I share my screen?
Yeah, sure. Dr. Aparna Kadare is Associate Professor Radiology at Tata Memorial Hospital, and she is within the Uro-Oncology Disease Management Group, and he has gracefully agreed to teach this radiology in adrenal lesions with a very short notice request. I mean, Gaurang sir had already told me, but
we are very thankful to her. It's going to be a real boost. Means the students will learn a lot. Please go ahead, Aparna.
Can you hear me?
Yeah,
yes,
can.
And can you see my screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, we can see.
Okay, great. So thank you for having me over, and it's nice to listen to clinical talk, because otherwise we are all about black and white and gray and all shades in between. So so this is a talk that I generally take for radiology residents. So there are some technical things here which I'll skip through, but there are some things which are important and I'll be stressing on them, because these are certain things that we it's great if the referring physicians know. So for adrenal imaging, how we as radiologists intend to make a difference is if the adrenal lesions are incidentalomas, which are in an institute like Tata or even elsewhere, a scan done for something else and suddenly an adrenal lesion is seen popping up and you don't really know the significance if any of that study, or it is a dedicated study where the patient is a known case of adrenal lesion detected either on ultrasound or something like the present case where you're strongly suspecting an adrenal lesion here. An incident lomia by definition is greater than 1 centimeter, which means that something that is less than 1 centimeter, it's very difficult to characterize that lesion, and it has to be interpreted in whole in keeping the clinical profile in mind, and cannot be without a clinical history cannot be characterized fully well. And in fact, if there is no relevant clinical history, then it's okay to even observe these lesions if they are less than 1 centimeter. So our role is to detect, characterize, and then advise about the further investigations or further line of management, regarding a definitive diagnosis. So this has to be a symbiotic effort between the radiologists, surgeons, and endocrinologists. Standalone, one person not able to do much. So this is the protocol. Now, at the end of the case, Mihir and Ashish both asked for a CT study of abdomen pelvis with delayed. No, please do not do that. If you're looking for an adrenal pathology and you're sending a patient for a CT, make sure you write that it is a CT with an adrenal protocol. An adrenal protocol is a bit different from a routine CT scan with contrast, where what we do is 3 mm sections with 1 mm recon, that's okay. These are all technical things. There has to be an unenhanced phase. If you write at many centers, a plain scan is not done many a times. And it is crucial when you're looking for adrenal lesions that you have a plain scan and unenhanced phase, because a lot of, as I will discuss later, why it is important. And then the contrast is given, and the venous phase at 70 seconds, that's fine. That is pretty much standard. What is important is that the delayed phase here is at 15 minutes. If you just write CT abdo-pelvis with delayed phase, a routine delayed phase for abdo-pelvis patients generally done at around anywhere between 5 to 7 minutes. But in an adrenal protocol CT, it's important that it's done at 15 minutes because of certain calculations which are done later, taking the HU values into consideration. So why the delayed phase at 15 minutes? Because we have to measure the attenuation. Attenuation are the HU values or whatever values that we get when we put the region of interest into that adrenal lesion. And important that we, this is a technical thing that radiologists should know, that the ROI should occupy half to two-thirds of the lesion area. So the crucial thing here, why we obtain a 15-minute phase, is because we have to know the absolute washout or relative washout. So now if we know that we are looking for an adrenal pathology, then it's always, the absolute washout value is always better to have. And for that, the formula is the HU value on the venous phase minus the HU value on delayed phase divided by the HU value on the venous phase minus plane. So here we see we need all these phases, and the delayed has to be at 15 minutes, which is a typical adrenal protocol. So an absolute washout value of greater than 60% is generally seen in an adenoma. And adenomas are the majority of adrenal incidentalomas. And it's important to rule out, I mean, most of the adrenal imaging is about adenomas versus non-adenomas, because adenomas are that common. And relative washout is something that we rely on when it is an adrenal incidentaloma. The scan was done for something else, and suddenly you find that there was an adrenal lesion, but you had no idea you were going to find it. That's why a plain scan was never done, and a contrast study was done. You don't have a plain scan there, but then during the venous phase, you did see that there is the adrenal lesion. Now, a smart technician or a smart radiologist who is monitoring the scan would now take the delayed not at the usual 5 minutes, but at 15 minutes, so that at least we can calculate the relative washout. The relative washout formula is venous phase HU minus delayed phase HU divided by the venous phase HU. So here we do not have the plain HU. And this value, when it is greater than 40%, that is when you classify the lesion as an adenoma. An MRI is done mainly as a chemical shift imaging. Sometimes, even after a CT, there may be a certain doubt regarding what the lesion exactly is. And sometimes in some institutes, if the decision is about it being an adenoma or a non-adenoma, then some institutes prefer chemical shift imaging, which is basically detecting the fat within the lesion. So adenomas can be lipid rich or lipid poor, but the lipid rich adenomas, chemical shift imaging with the in phase and post phase images characterizes the lesion if they are adenomas or not. So let's ignore these formulas right now and let's go on to the common adrenal lesions. So like I said, this is a series where, you know, on imaging, you find adenomas are almost 80% of the masses. And even in the surgical series, 55% are adenomas. So when you see adenomas versus non-adenomas, you can see how big the adenoma percentage is. So basically on imaging, especially in incidentalomas or otherwise, even in this case, if suppose the hormonal workup had been normal and then you had asked for an adrenal CT protocol or a CT just to look for if it's a renal pathology, and then incidentally you had seen an adrenal lesion, does that mean that you suddenly call it a pheochromocytoma or a functioning or a non-functioning pheochromocytoma? No. Adenomas have to be ruled out in all patients because these are the most common lesions. So we are basically talking of adenomas versus non-adenomas. So these are the most common incidentalomas where the intracytoplasmic lipid is what gives it its characteristic appearance. They are homogeneous and well-defined, and many a times even a plain CT is enough to characterize, because an HU value of less than 10 on plain CT, you can be very sure that this is a lipid-rich adenoma and nothing else needs to be done, not even a contrast study. If it is a homogeneous lesion, well-defined, well-circumscribed, not irregular, and has an HU value of less than 10. And similarly, on the chemical shift imaging on MRI, if there is a drop in signal on the out-of-phase images as compared to the in-phase images, I'll show you the images so it will be clear to you, then also it is an adenoma. The problem arises when lipid poor adenomas, where they don't behave and don't give the absolute and relative washout values like you would expect. And that is when a contrast study is important. And here it is, absolute washout of greater than 60 or relative washout of greater than 40%. If there is no plain scan, that is when you can diagnose it as an adenoma. Most of the adenomas are non-FDG avid. So if a PET CT is done, you are unlikely to find any activity in these. But there is a small percentage where you may find them to be FDG avid. So it's good to know that sometimes functioning adenomas can be FDG avid. So here's a typical example. This was an adrenal incidentaloma under investigation. So this was the lesion. It's quite homogeneous, quite well-defined, and this is how an ROI is taken, taking into consideration about more than 60% of the area. And the plain HU was 6. So ideally, even if we had not done a contrast in this patient, it would have been completely fine. Even on the plain study, you have diagnosed this as an adenoma. But nevertheless, since the patient came for an adrenal lesion evaluation, the study was completed. So these are the HU values on the venous phase and 15 minutes delayed phase. So the absolute washout was greater than 60, relative, not needed here, but if we did not have the plane, then the relative would have been greater than 40. And hence, we can, with a great deal of confidence, call it a lipid-rich adenoma. This is what I was talking about in chemical shift imaging, where you see that this is the in-phase image and this is the out-of-phase image where the fat is suppressed. And that is why you will see that this lesion is darker as compared to this. I think I have another one. This was one. And this was a case of a CA cervix and we did not know what this is. And just one chemical shift imaging in phase and opposed phase, you can see how the signal has dropped here. So you can say that this is a lipid-rich adenoma. Coming on to the next group of lesions, which are myelolipomas. Now, these are macroscopic fat. So this fat, like unlike an adenoma where the fat was not really visible to the naked eyes and you had to rely on the HU value and the absolute and relative washouts, in myelolipomas, it's very obvious that the fat is there even to the naked eyes. You can see the fat density there. They are mostly asymptomatic, but if the hemorrhage, then they can cause pain. Excuse me. Can I continue?
Yeah, please.
Okay. Let me show you. So this is very obvious that this is fat here. It's a huge lesion here. And this patient also, this was incidentally detected, such a huge lesion. So when do you intervene? If there's a guideline that if it's greater than 7 centimeters, then you may consider excision because they are more likely to bleed. This is a very small myelolipoma detected incidentally. Next are the cysts. They can be endothelial or they can be pseudocysts or parasitic, epithelial. These are just various types of cysts, and sometimes they have peripheral calcifications. It's good to know that sometimes even benign cysts can increase in size. It's pretty straightforward. You calculate the HU values and you know that it is a cystic lesion, and you don't need to do anything unless this patients are in pain, because if sometimes they grow to big size, the patients may be in pain, and very easily the cyst can be aspirated under CT guidance, and many a times that relieves the pain. Adrenal hemorrhage is maybe either traumatic or non-traumatic due to recent stress of any kind, like surgery, sepsis. Excuse me. They may resolve completely or persist as pseudocysts. So this was a patient of CA left buccal mucosa who had this hypotensive crisis and fever. So basically the scan was done to look if there is any hemorrhage anywhere or why this patient is suddenly in crisis. And this was an incidental finding where the adrenal, this is a plain scan, this is a venous. You can see that it is quite bright even on the plain face. When you measure the HU, this was 53 and on the venous it was 58. So it did not enhance, but on the plain also the HU value was similar to that of blood. So this was diagnosed as a adrenal hemorrhage. This is another patient where this is sequelae to an old hemorrhage where there is a pseudocyst, thick walled pseudocyst formation. So again, nothing much to do about this. Very common problem in an institute like Tata is whether an adrenal lesion is metastatic or not. That's the many a times it is a cause of headache, and these are discussed then in MDTs, and it's extremely important in such cases that an adrenal protocol CT is done, because the measurements and the HU values become of great significance in these cases. So METs can be from lung, breast, GI tract or kidneys. So again, washout will be now less than 60 as against adenomas. Relative washout less than 40%. These are variable homogeneity, variable margins, and there will be no signal drop on chemical shift imaging unless the metastasis is coming from a primary which is fat rich, such as an HCC. So many a times if you're not able to prove, and if the diagnosis of this adrenal lesion is going to change the management of the patient, in spite of imaging, if you're not really sure what is happening, and that is a common indication where you could then biopsy the patient. So this is a patient of a germ cell tumor of testis, had extensive metastasis, excuse me, lung, liver, and here is a left adrenal met. You can see that it is has some solid component, some cystic component as well. This was another patient. Now, you can, you know, in your mind, you can work this out, that this has a plain HU of 41, incidentally detected lesion, venous phase HU of 88, delayed phase HU of 60. So I'm telling you that the absolute washout is 59%. Now, this is something that is, you know, so close to 60. You cannot really be 100% sure that it is not an adenoma just because it is 59%. So you're kind of in a dilemma what to do about this. And you can see that there are two lesions here. One here, maybe on the coronal, you'll be able to see better. Yeah, there are two lesions here. And they show very mild activity. They are not even very highly FDG avid. So now this is a diagnostic dilemma, especially if it is an incidentally detected lesion. So what do you do now? the clinical history is extremely important, and that can really clinch the diagnosis. Now, if I tell you that this was a 35-year-old male patient who has been operated for medullary CA thyroid in the past, your excuse me, your antenna will go up and you'll start thinking of pheochromocytoma in a meant to be syndrome. So coming to pheochromocytomas, which this case was hinting towards, so they can be adrenal medullary paraganglioma. It's a 10% tumor where there are 10% bilateral, 10% are malignant, 10% are extra-adrenal. It can be syndromic. They show intense enhancement and they're bright on T2-weighted. Now, what is bright on T2-weighted images? Normally, fluid, any kind of fluid cyst is generally bright on T2-weighted. But these are solid lesions which are bright on T2-weighted images and show intense enhancement without any signal drop. As they grow larger, they may become necrotic, and benign non-functioning ones can grow to even large size because they stay silent, and local invasion and distant metastasis is known. We just discussed plasma and urinary metanephrine levels. So it is important to ensure, if you intend to biopsy these lesions, that they are hormonally inactive before you biopsy these lesions. So here's another patient with a very big pheochromocytoma, and because it is big, it has grown to be necrotic in a young hypertensive. It was very bright, as you see FDG AVID. And anyone can take a guess about what this is. So anyone of Ashish and Veer, can you take a guess what this, what is this patient? It's a spot diagnosis.
Bright signal intensity is...
No, I do not want any description. Just tell me what this is.
Macronodular hyperplasia could be.
Paraganglioma.
Okay, great. So, you know, let's start with the, what all are the abnormalities? Is there something in the left kidney that's wrong?
Bad? Left kidney, there is a heterointense, ill-defined, heterointense lesion on the left kidney.
Fine.
On the
all right. Upper. So there is a left kidney. Does it appear to be cyst or does it appear to be something?
It is heterogeneously enhanced.
Correct. So there is some solid component. Then what else is there? What is this? Is this normal structure or is there something here?
The suprarenal gland enlarged.
Correct. So there is something in the left
atrium. Enhancement.
Right. So there is a left
atrium. Necrotic.
Okay, fine. And what organ is this and what is this happening? Is this normal, abnormal?
Would be pancreas.
This is pancreatic mass.
Okay. And these are T2 bright. I just said yes. T2 bright. What would it be? New most window. T2 bright thing? No. Most T2 bright stuff anywhere. This is also T2 bright. The spinal CSF. So it's fluid. Basically fluid. Exactly. Fluid. Exactly. So these are multiple fluid filled areas. So these are basically multiple cysts.
Cyst.
Yeah. And there is one solid cystic lesion here also. So together, what do you think is happening here? What do you think?
Nature complex. It could
correct.
Be.
Correct. This is Monopil-Lindau syndrome. Good. Great. Now moving on to the most sinister of them, adrenocortical carcinoma. It has a bimodal age of presentation. 60% of them can be functional. And these are typically large and heterogeneous. So pheochromocytomas, when they grow, they tend to be quite well marginated. Even if there is a central necrosis, they are not irregular. However, adrenocortical carcinomas are solid, they are heterogeneous, and they are typically irregular, have irregular margins. Some show calcification and they may show vascular invasion also. So typically in a large adrenal mass, you are stuck many a times whether this is an adrenocortical carcinoma or a pheochromocytoma. And these kind of features may help you take a guess of one thing more than another. Frequently metastatic, and there is a risk of capsule breakdown and tumor seeding in a biopsy. So it's not recommended if you're definitely going in and removing the lesion. Of course, Dr. Ganesh Bakshi will be able to speak about this better. So this is a large adrenocortical carcinoma with calcification within. This patient later on recurred with a pelvic mass as well. So these are quite aggressive, as you know. this was a patient who was under investigation for a back pain, and this MRI, this is a CT of course, but it discovered that there was a lesion in the D11 vertebra, and then that's why a CT was done, which then showed the primary to be left suprarenal mass and adrenocortical carcinoma. You can also see that there are liver mets here. And this is invasion of the left suprarenal vein by the mass. You can see the way it is enlarged and draining there. And coming to bilateral adrenal lesion. Now, these sometimes cause a lot of headache to radiologists because you can see something like this, 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 and they are all different cases, and we'll take them one by one. So in this case, this was metastasis from intestinal melanoma, and there is no way you can diagnose this unless you know that there is a history of melanoma. And these are bilateral adrenal masses which are hypodense. you would suspect that maybe this is granulomatous, but these turned out to be lymphoma. So lymphomas, non-Hodgkin's, are more common in the adrenal, obviously. They typically have a mantle kind of growth anywhere. So they are encased, encasing kind of growth. Sometimes they can be discrete masses, and very often they are bilateral. Almost 50% are bilateral, and MR, they show restricted diffusion. They are FDG avid. Now this patient, you can see that it is, these are multiple cystic kind of areas in big adrenal masses, bilateral. These are typical appearances of granulomatous disease. It can either be TB or it can be histoplasmosis. This one was histoplasmosis. Necrotic lesions, frequently bilateral and heal with calcifications. And this is how they heal. And here there are bilateral adrenal lesions which are, you know, they maintain the adrenal contour. It's just that there is nodularity. And this is seen in adrenocortical hyperplasia. You can see that on the PET, this was not at all active. So there are some outliers that you need to be aware, but you know, that just leave this to the radiologist. That we need to be aware of these. And just a quick word on the approach, that what we have to decide is whether we leave them alone or if they should be under regular surveillance or there is an immediate intervention required. So we need to know what is happening. These are a couple of papers which give a guideline as to how they can be managed. So criteria for benign ETR, if it's less than 4 centimeter homogeneous, well-defined, and a CTHU value of less than 10. If all these things are criteria fulfilled, only then you can say with a certain amount of confidence that it is a benign lesion, could be an adenoma, myelolipoma, or a simple cyst, and nothing more needs to be done. However, if it is greater than 4 centimeter with malignancy elsewhere, you could consider a biopsy or a PET CT. If there is no history of malignancy in a singular mass greater than 4 centimeter, then you can consider it resection. If it is between 1 to 4 centimeter but stable because you have a prior imaging, then you can call it benign. But if it's new or growing, then with a history of malignancy, again, similarly, you can either do a biopsy or PET CT. And if there is no history, then you can consider resection or following it up. But in 1 to 4 centimeter masses with no prior imaging, if there is history of malignancy elsewhere, again, if there is a history, then a biopsy or a PET CT or resection follow-up, whatever is relevant there. But if there is no history of malignancy, you may consider just following it up, and it could be probably benign lesion. But if it is 2 to 4 centimeter, again, you go here, and that's it. So there are a few caveats, but I think we'd skip them for now because I don't want to take too much time. So, and obviously this is something that you guys know better, but a radiologist resident kind of needs to be aware that a hormonal parallel workup is extremely important in such cases. So that's it from me.
Yeah, Aparna, it was really fantastic. And I'm sure all the students, you know, all the CT scan, whatever you've shown, it was, really very good. So thank you very much. Ganesh, you want to add anything to this?
Thank you so much, Aparna, for spending your late night time with us.
No, thank you. Thanks a lot for having me. I enjoyed being here. If there are any questions, I can take them in the box. But if it's okay after answering the questions, I would like to take leave. If that's
yeah,
fine.
Yeah, please, please.
Yeah, thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah, so just if students, if you have got any question, you can just ask them just now. So you can put it in on the chat box. Yes, Mihir, Ashish, do you want to ask anything?
Madam, whether we can oops differentiate...
sir, is there any role of... Sir?
Yes, Ashish, first you ask, then Mihir will ask, and there is one question in the chat box.
Hello. Sir, there's a question, yes, sir. Hello. Sir, any light on the sir gallium 68 sir Dotonex scan, sir? Dotatec PET scan, PET scan.
Yeah, that's done in a few chromos, but I mean, I'm not a nuclear medicine person. I'm not the best person to talk about it, but you know, in fact, maybe Dr. Ganesh would know better when you would we'll get a Dotatec in, I mean, in spite of the CT findings.
Yeah.
Madam, whether we can differentiate, like you mentioned, PO versus adrenal cortical cancer. So whether we can differentiate metastatic lesion versus adrenal cortical cancer?
So for calling anything metastatic, you need to have a primary. So if there is a primary, then obviously the lesion is... you know, the suspicion of metastasis is more. So in that case, actually, more than metastasis versus adrenocortical carcinoma, I would be thinking more in terms of metastasis versus adenoma. So adenomas are more common, and that's what I've been stressing, that, you know, you would want to rule out an adenoma before calling it a mets. So, and again, if you are in a doubt, then you would go ahead with a biopsy. And you're in a doubt, and it makes a difference what that lesion is in terms of the whole patient scenario, then yes, you would go ahead with the biopsy. But you can, I mean, with the help of HU values, you can always, more often than not, if it, it is a proper adrenal protocol CT that is performed, you can differentiate whether it's a MET or an adenoma. At least you can definitely say that it is an adenoma so that an unnecessary biopsy is avoided.
Okay.
So that is what I'm saying. If there is one take-home message I want to give here, it is that as referring clinicians, please, if you're looking at an adrenal pathology, please make sure that you write that you want an adrenal protocol CT so that there is no confusion. Even if it's a technologist, he knows that an adrenal protocol CT is slightly different from a usual CT.
Thank you.
Yeah.
One small question. So CT with adrenal protocol is generally recommended for all adrenal cases, but when you will recommend this MRI in case of adrenal?
So again, so here's the thing. There are certain institutes that prefer a chemical shift MRI rather than a CT. But it is one, an institutional preference. We as an institution prefer CT and we are pretty comfortable with it. And I mean, it's completely fine if some other institute prefers an MR. But there has been one study where they've said that if, like I said, if the HU value is less than 10, then you're pretty sure that it's a lipid-rich adenoma. If the HU value is somewhere between 10 and 30, that is when sometimes in some institutes or in a study, it has been postulated that an chemical shift MRI would be better. But again, these are very technical things. To answer your question, it is a very institution-specific decision whether you do a CT or an MR. A CT generally gives way more information. Now, in this patient, if it was an, I believe this patient didn't have hypertension, but suppose it was a hypertensive under investigation, an MRI would not give as much info. It would just answer. An MRI is basically a problem solving modality. So in this case, you know, even after a CT, if there was a certain doubt about, you know, it being a borderline lesion may not be fat, then a chemical shift sometimes helps a lot. But a CT would, you know, answer a lot of questions here, even regards to renal artery stenosis, renal pathology, if any. So, you know, when you're kind of in the dark, like in this patient, except till you came to the plasma metanephrine levels, you were kind of in the dark whether you are even dealing with an intra-abdominal or a cardiac pathology. So in that case, a CT kind of, you know, helps much more than an MR.
And we can diagnose, ma'am, this paraganglium of skull base and make generally with CT?
Yes, of course.
Thank you, ma'am.
So something someone has asked about MIBG scan.
Yeah, so again, I'm not really an expert in MIBG. No,
what we generally do is we would like to do MIBGs in the post surgery few follow up, or if there is a PGL or something. And today the use of few goes less, maybe before we give MIBG therapy. Ketan Pandya has just written MIBG and question. So I don't know what he wants actually. So role of FIO today is different after what when I was a student, where we used to have only an MIBG scan, nothing more. And today we have probably the MRI and the PET scan, which FDG PET scan probably which tell us much more. Secondly, about somebody had asked about Dotatate. Ashish, you asked Dotatate or Dotanoc.
Dotatex, sir.
Okay. So there are a lot of PET scans available and Dotatate can be done, but not in the primary phase at all. Sometimes in the PGLs or in the residual PGLs or with the recurrent PGLs, maybe when you want to give some therapeutic intention. If Dotatate SSR is going to be positive, then we can maybe tag lutetium or something and give some therapies. So I guess those are the end scenarios in probably today's discussion right now. That's why I said we'll discuss later, but might as well finish it off here. So commonest PET scan done is FDG PET.
Yeah.
I think, should we go on with the case?
Yeah, so let us go on. So yes, okay, thank you very much, Aparna.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks a lot.
And we just remember, we are going to call you again.
Sure, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Sir,
coming back to the case.
Yeah, let us go ahead.
The plasma cortisol level is elevated.
Coming back to, I'll give a short summary. So he's a 25 years old male, presented with palpitation, increased sweating and vomiting. On examination wise, he was having tachycardia. Rest of the systemic examination seems to be normal. So on functional workup, there was an elevated plasma free non-metanephrine levels. Rest of the functional workups was normal, except this 24-hour urinary VMA.
And cortisol level also, I want.
So rest of them functional was normal.
Okay.
Yes, Josh, next what?
So further, we would like to have, sir, CT scan, multiphasic CT scan with, sir, delayed adrenal protocol. 15 minutes adrenal protocol.
So say properly now. Okay. So what do you mean by, just now you have heard it. So what are the important features of adrenal protocol?
Sir, in adrenal protocol, we will have, sir, non-contrast CT scan first, plain CT scan. Followed by, we'll have a 5-minute, sir, venous phase, then a delayed phase of 15 minutes.
70 seconds, venous phase.
70 seconds.
And then 15 minutes delayed.
15 minutes for delays.
Ganesh, am I right?
Yes, sir. More than 60% washout at 15-minute delay time.
Yeah. Okay. So, can you show us?
So, coming to the CT scan. So these are the CT done with the adrenal protocol. So I'm showing the relevant.
So So I guess this will be a representative scan image. I mean, it looks an arterial phase, but Baki, it's with you to comment. Anyone, Meer can also answer.
Sir, once again, repeat.
Yeah, so that's the representative thing now.
Yeah. Sir,
represent
you. Yeah.
With RTL and
we are already 10 PM plus.
Yes, sir.
Any, we are already at 10:15, so you need to slightly go faster.
Okay, sir. Plain and RTL phase of CT scan. Showing left-sided suprarenal mass lesion with fluid-like consistencies related to maybe adrenal cyst or can be a PHEO. I would like to know the report.
You already have the norepinephrine values, which are high. So,
yes, sir.
So, as you follow with the investigations, you are correlating one with the another. So, you talk decisively now.
Yeah, it is left-sided suprarenal mass could be adrenal pheochromocytoma.
Okay.
I could not see any renal vein
What about the margin? What about the infiltration? What about the metastasis? What is the size? So in fact, what are the indications for malignancy? Nowadays, they say only the metastasis means malignancy. But what are the things which will suspect malignancy? In this case, what are the things you can see?
If the sizes are more than 6 cm and margins are irregular, then irregular enhancement is there also on the rim. Then
it would be
necrosis is seen at the center. And no calcification is not there.
What about local infiltration? Can you see?
Not able to make out, sir. Local infiltration.
Ashish, your size relation was with respect to malignancy, right?
Malignancy, yes, sir.
So if the size is less than 4 cm, there is about 2% chance of malignancy.
Malignancy. And 4 to 6 is 6%, and more than 6 is 90%, sir.
So more than 6 cm, 6 to 8 is 25, and more than 8% is 47 to 80%.
Yes, sir.
What you said is 90% of the adrenocortical carcinomas are more than 5 cm when found.
Okay.
I mean, I'm just saying some statistics.
Okay, sir.
So go ahead with the next
report. CT scan report.
Probably got the size, okay, whatever. Would they show the report and the size, please?
Yeah. Yes, sir. So it's okay. A peripherally enhancing with central necrotic lesion of size 6.3 into 4 cm seen in the left suprarenal gland. Superiorly, it's abutting with splenic vein with loss of fat planes. Pancreas and jejunum are abutted with maintained flat fat planes. Medially, it's abutting the diaphragmatic crura with loss of fat planes. On arterial phase, the HU is 104. On venous phase, it's 120. On delayed, it's 76. So absolute percent washout is 45% and relative percent washout is 27%. So remaining viscera is normal, thorax is normal.
So yes, okay, Ashish, just now you have heard.
Sir, looking at the report, sir, as absolute washout is 45% and relative washout is 27%. It is either lipid poor adenoma or a pheochromocytoma. Or looking at the blood plasma metanephrines, most probably a pheochromocytoma, sir. And could be, sir,
with malignant features, could be.
With malignant features, sir. Locally invaded pheochromocytoma.
Loss of fat plane.
Yeah. Fine.
Okay.
So yeah, now only question: when you will do biopsy and when you will not do biopsy? When you will not do biopsy?
Sir, if adrenal lesion is locally advanced and if it is malignant or metastases are there, and if you are planning for giving chemotherapy, then we can.
Tell me when you will not do biopsy.
When it is a functional tumor,
when it is a
it's a pheochromocytoma, you'll not do biopsy. Second,
lesion is less than 4 cm, no malignant features, adenoma.
So they say adenocortical malignancy, because you may not yield anything, and second thing, there are chances that you may do seeding. Ganesh, am I right?
Yes, sir. So if there is no management change, you don't do a biopsy. There are certain things like that.
Okay, so can you just tell them when we do biopsy?
So whenever we think that it is functional, we don't do a biopsy, as you already discussed. Whenever we don't expect a management change, wherever imaging does give the diagnosis, imaging matlab combination of imaging, we don't do a biopsy. If it is very much indeterminate, and another indication is when you have a prior history of one more malignancy along with. These are the few indications of a biopsy.
Yeah, and if you are saying if there is a metastatic tumors in the adrenal, then we do biopsy. In myelolipoma, we do biopsy, and in cases of
what I said was, if imaging is very confident of the diagnosis, like myelolipoma, we don't do a biopsy.
Unresectable, locally advanced metastatic disease, agar hai, toh there is a role of biopsy.
So if there is a prior history of another malignancy and it is indeterminate with the current imaging.
And prior to starting the systemic therapy, medical treatment, if in such cases.
That is true. I have not told you that. Correct, sir.
Sir, one question, sir. If primary lesion in adrenal we resected and again recurrence is there, that time it is indicated for biopsy, sir?
Always it is not.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Correct.
I mean, always it is not an indication for a biopsy.
Okay.
Okay, so now this is a situation. Now next what?
I think
Ashish, what do you want to do now?
Sir, as it appears to be a locally advanced tumor, I would like to do a sir FDG PET scan to rule out metastasis also, sir, as a metastatic workup.
So okay. Do you always need a metastatic workup?
Not usually, sir.
In this kind of lesion, what you did?
This kind of lesion, sir.
Okay.
As it is locally advanced, so we can ask for sir PET scan.
So let me ask you one question. Like,
okay,
CEOs sometimes are cystic. Like, so what happens actually? Cystic? Why cystic?
Yes, sir. I couldn't get your question, sir.
I mean, usually CEOs are solid.
Yes, sir.
Very rarely you get who have cystic nature.
Sir, not a good answer.
There can be
because of secreting
degeneration. A lot of things can happen.
Cystic degeneration.
Quite a vascular.
Okay, sir.
So you have a norepinephrine level, which is about 2000. You have now a left adrenal mass. You have many things actually, which tell you the diagnosis. So what I'm asking is PET CT mandatory?
So not mandatory, just to complete a workup, metastatic work. Or I can ask for CT chest also.
Okay.
What you are expecting here? You are what is your diagnosis?
Sir, I am expecting a pheochromocytoma, a malignant pheochromocytoma. Yes, sir.
Why?
Sir, the norepinephrine levels are quite high, and the lesion is locally advanced, sir.
So that is the reason you are expecting.
And along, yes, sir.
Because on the contrary, why not? It is a functioning adrenocortical carcinoma. It is more than 6 centimeters. Irregular borders, irregular enhancement, necrotic area, cystic degeneration, everything is locally advanced.
Size, morphology, everything deals with that. I mean, what Gita sir is saying.
Because the classical picture of adrenocortical carcinoma on CT, majority things fits here.
Ashish, what you are trying to say is metastatic few, right?
Yes.
That is usually said when we have lymph nodes or whatever other sites having few along with adrenal. So what Gita sir is saying?
So it could be ACC also.
So you should think first, no?
Yes, sir.
Because you are stuck with one diagnosis. More than 6 centimeters, necrotic changes, cystic degeneration, locally advanced.
Yes,
everything fits radiologically. Functioning bhi reh sakta.
We can keep it as a diagnosis, sir. Adrenal corticoglands.
Fine. So now what you want FTG? Uday, have you done it?
Yes, sir. You have done it.
Yeah, show him. So in exam, Ganesh, what you say, the student should say about this, or they should say about only CT chest?
Sir, one thing is right what he said, that if you technically sometimes want to differentiate between malignant and benign, FDG PET helps you a good length, because it will technically be, there are very small percent of FDG avid at adenomas. That is for one thing. With respect to cancer, like it will be a little bit variable, and with respect to few and PGLs, it is going to highlight it very densely.
Okay.
So you will have to correlate a certain things.
So in this case, it is required. And it is.
In this case, it was required, so we did it.
Yeah.
So the FDG PET and report.
Just report.
Yes, sir. So there was a 6 by 7 centimeter FDG avid lesion with SUV max of 5.8, a well-defined peripherally enhancing lesion with internal hypodense foci involving the left supralillar renal region, more in favor of metabolic active pheochromocytoma.
Yeah.
So this FDG avidness is there in the non-cystic areas of that adrenal lesion.
Yes. It is only a locally advanced metabolically active pheochromocytoma.
So now what do you want to do?
Now will you manage the patient?
Sir, I will counsel the patient regarding the disease of this diagnosis and give various treatment options to the patient in the form of sir surgery, and we'll have an endocrinologist consult and one cardiologist consult, as he was in beta blocker. For surgery, if I will require alpha blockade, beta blocker should be stopped. So how much days to be stopped, I would consult with cardiologist.
Beta blocker will be
stopped, sir, because before giving alpha blockade, beta blocker should be stopped, sir.
Okay, right.
So how will you start? So you will prepare this patient. How will you prepare this patient?
Around 10 to 14 days prior to the surgery, I will subject this patient for alpha blockade in the form of sulfenoxybenzamine, 10 milligrams BID, if it is available, or we give ciprazosine, 5 milligram BID. And if alpha blockade is achieved, ciprazosine, because it is readily available, and phenoxybenzamine is not available, and it is non-selective also.
Non-selective, and it is costlier also.
Yes.
So all the three reasons, today we select alpha blocker, and that is not phenoxybenzamine. Okay?
Yes, sir. As we get the adequacy of alpha blockade, we start, sir, a patient on beta blocker. And if our institution don't prefer for metirosin, sir, followed by one or two days prior to the surgery, we will measure his blood pressure. It should be 120 by 90 on a sitting, 120 by 80 on a sitting position. And prior day of surgery, we will give a bolus IV fluids. And sir, in this 14 days, we will give him sodium 15 milligrams per day also in the form of oral, and 4 liters of fluids every day, sir, for this 14 days.
What about calcium?
If sir, still the blood pressure is not controlled with this alpha blockers and beta blocker, then we can go for calcium channel blockers.
Ganesh, you want to say anything on this?
How do you confirm there is adequate alpha blocker?
So there is a Rosen criteria in which indoor blood pressure should not be more than 160 by 90 millimeter of mercury, and whatever the orthostatic hypotension happens, it should not be below less than 80 by 45 millimeter mercury. And in ECG, if you find more than 5 VPCs per minute, then that is not adequacy. And in ECG, ST segment and T wave changes is there 1 week prior to the surgery, within skeleton, 1 week of surgery.
Skeleton barabar bola andar ka material.
Sorry, sir.
Parietal blood pressure should be less than 160 by 95 in last 48 hour before surgery.
Yes.
Measured in stressful environment.
Okay.
Not stress free. It is stressful.
Stressful.
Okay. Then orthostatic hypotension, you are told correctly, less than 80 by
45.
ECG pre-op ST changes more than 2 weeks.
1 week.
Two weeks. Sir. Ventricular ectopic less than 1 over 5 minutes.
Sir, it number per minute or sir, it's 5 VPCs per minute?
No, it is 1 over 5 minutes. 8 minutes mein ek minimum ek hi aana chahiye.
Okay.
So that is called as Rosen criteria. So criteria name also you are told correct.
Okay, we proceed.
Okay, we proceed. So now you have prepared the patient, you have given saline, you have given sodium, you have given alpha blocker, beta blocker, you have given calcium channel. Everything is under control. Now what do you like to do?
Sir, we will proceed for the surgery. We will have a good communication with anesthetist while performing surgery also. And we will
subject this like patient.
Sir, fluid. Preoperatively, sir, we give fluid, sir.
That you have given. You have done everything. But you will stop here.
On early morning dose of antihypertensive should be stopped.
How will you measure arterial blood pressure? How will you measure the CVP?
So that will be done per operatively, sir. They will put a central venous line and arterial line. The anesthetist will put a central venous line, arterial line.
These are the two most important. Ganesh, what do you say?
Right. Yes, I agree with that. I mean, at our place, they put just an arterial line.
Okay, but arterial line is best,
yes,
right?
Yes, sir.
So that helps them to get a straightforward, accurate measurement of the MAP throughout the surgery.
Yes. Fine. Okay, go ahead. Ashish.
Sir, we will subject this patient for open left-sided adrenalectomy.
Which anesthesia?
Yes, sir.
Which anesthesia?
Sir, under general anesthesia.
Which drug and, to be added as induction agent?
Sir, for induction, we will give propofol. We will avoid halothane for induction and maintenance. It would be, sir, SIBO or isoflurane, not halothane.
Halothane कौन use कर रहा है
आजकल? नहीं use करेंगे sir. No use it sir.
Ketamine is not.
आजकल ऐसे
ketamine for induction ketamine is not being used. Only propofol is used. And for sir maintenance isoflurane or sir sevoflurane.
Asked a question is simple. Which drug is not used as induction agent? Answer is ketamine.
Ketamine and sir halothane.
That's all. इधर उधर का घुमा फिरा के ज़्यादा बताने का ज़रूरी नहीं.
Okay sir.
As a part of preparation. Suppose hypertension crisis हो सकता है किसी में हो सकता है in spite of having adequate control उसके लिए क्या क्या red drug ready रखें
sir
peroxidase क्या क्या drug ready रखना चाहिए
हाँ sir we will keep lobetalol we will keep sodium nitroprusside NTG and phentolamine to control the hypertensive crisis
small all
to arrhythmias control arrhythmias
nitroglycerin na
yes sir
and how is it small and propofol
okay so now what Ganesh what is the management which one is preferred open or laparoscopic
sir I mean anything can be done there are two views here actually grossly but we can say whatever probably the exam whatever the institute does the view of endocrine related society is slightly different in tumors more than 5 cm and all they don't advise laparoscopic or minimally invasive surgery but as far as urological associations go all over the world they say that you can go ahead with laparoscopic surgery general principle is do the same surgery and do not have a tumor related contamination anywhere because still actually it comes out we don't know what is it it's a few it's secreting ACC we don't know so no contamination
okay. So if you are suspecting malignancy then open surgery is better na
sir I mean if you are this is what has been that's what it's been propagated by the endocrine surgeon society but whenever there are urologists and uroncologists doing surgeries lap and robotic both are done
okay
and it is acceptable only thing is you have to be rigid in the principles
okay fine so what you did then anything you want to ask about before you answer
nahi sir he has already said the pre surgery preparation almost the intraoperative management and approach like we can ask him steps of surgery a little while Uday what have we done in this case can you just finish it off
so the patient came with us with MIBG scan and MIBG scan so was also showing
most of our patients get worked up at KM hospital so sometimes very rarely they do all the scans of all the patients and everything Yes, Uday, continue.
So, here, MIBG scan was not.
The endocrine.
Hey, MIBG scan he has shown, sir. Uday, uska report batao.
So this is the MIBG scan. So
lesion in left suprarenum.
So showed a concentrating lesion left suprarenum.
So MIBG is diagnostic of PO technically. FDG PET is usually thought to be done in cases of either metastatic questionable lesion or in PGLs, paragangliomas, because they will have multiple lesions technically. Or then sometimes you do an FDG PET when you have a metastatic PO, malignant PO. Sorry.
Sir, can we go for sir Dotanoc for this if we want to have a PO?
Dotanoc scan you are asking. It goes for a neuroendocrine tumor, where here I don't think we are suspecting neuroendocrine technique.
Okay, sir.
That Dota Tate which you asked, I already answered. Gallium labeled Dota Tate. I answered you.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so Uday, continue.
Yeah, so the Endocrine has advised alpha blockers and beta blocker. Alpha blocker was started 2 weeks before, and tablet prazosin 5 mg was started in the prescribed shown doses. And later, 1 week before the surgery, tablet metoprolol XL 25 mg was started. Patient was adequately blocked with this medications 2 weeks after that he was taken for a surgery. So we did a lap, a left adrenalectomy.
Okay, histopathology.
And this was the histopathology report. So it was suggestive of left adrenal gland tumor arranging diffuse sheets with individual tumor cells. So mitotic count was 1 to 3 per 10 HPFs. LVI is not seen. Invasion in adjacent fat is not seen. Moreover, the impression was pheochromocytoma.
So it was not a malignancy.
Yes, it localized.
No, sir, it was not malignant. So the images sometimes will show when the tumor is big in size, or maybe there was a hemorrhage and then cystic pheo. We don't know. So sometimes it was mentioned that some of the planes were not good and some of the fatty planes were maintained very well. So it technically came out well with the laparoscopy.
Okay.
So generally, many times what happens is in case of pheo where we have raised catecholamines, or sometimes even not raised catecholamines, we have patients getting shifted out of the OT on inotropic supports. So Ashish,
You can ask Ashish.
How does the patients recover generally?
Patient recovery, regular monitoring of blood pressure is to be done, sir. If still the hypertension is there, we can continue with the antihypertensives and gradually decrease the dose and stop. If there is no hypertension, we can stop the medicines. And after 2 weeks, we will send, metenephrine levels again for any recurrence, to see any recurrence or leftover pheochromocytoma. According to that, we will proceed, sir.
Yeah, I think that's correct. Sometimes what we have seen is immediately post of the inotropic is needed, and usually till the other adrenal, which is quite suppressed all over the time, for a long time, it takes over the catecholamines secretion. Till then, the patient may need a small support. Rarely we need to give some hydrocortisone or something. What would be the difficulties or what would be the challenges in such a case intraoperatively? Mihir, can you answer that?
Intraoperatively, sir, challenges would be because of...
What are the complications of the surgery? May it be open, may it be lab, or may it be robotic? Yeah, let us combine all three and discuss the...
Sir, hypotension and sir, hypoglycemia.
Intraop hypoglycemia.
Because of tumor manipulation or because of rupturing of the tumor, it can be catastrophic to be manage hypertension for the anesthesia side and further proceeding, or it can be...
Handling of the tumor will give you release of catecholamines and hypertension secondary to that managed for the anesthetist.
Yes.
So what about you?
Sir, we will first ligate the adrenal vein.
Okay.
To prevent crisis and minimal handling. And in case we are doing laparoscopically, then we will keep the pressure low, around 10 millimeter mercury. And
okay. So these are good points, actually. Keep the pressure a little low so it does not compress or so much on the gland. But a small difference, which probably I have noticed in my experience, is that if you're doing laparoscopy, then, I mean, even if you mobilize the tumor, usually the manipulation is not so much. I mean, our anesthetists are extremely happy when I tell them in the morning that I'm going to do the lap. The moment I tell them open, they are in a quite a tension. I mean, lap, many times it has gone so well that, or robotic, we have rarely done. I mean, not given preference to adrenal robotically, but laparoscopic was really well, and you can clip the veins, but before you clip the last venous supply, that is most important. You should always mention it to the anesthetist. You should always mention it to the anesthetist, because till the last 2-3 veins are patent, wherever small veins, they may be draining anywhere. You know, the venous drainage of adrenal, it is almost all round. The main vein goes into the IVC. I mean, and on the left side goes into the
adrenal. On the left side,
But when you typically clip the last veins, that is when actually there is a crash. This crash is related to our pre-op management and intravascular fluid dynamics being maintained, but invariably there is a crash. So it's important to tell the anesthetist. I think adrenal pe sir to discussion PO pe to almost ho gaya hai. If we can just, you know, go. Suppose
so we can go ahead to the extra adrenal.
Extra adrenal 10%.
Yeah, paraganglioma.
So Mir,
can you ask them question about that paraganglioma?
Can you talk on extra adrenal views?
Sir, 30% are extra adrenal paraganglioma. Most common site is organ of Zucker Candle, which is on the anterolateral side of the, between the bifurcation of aorta and IMS, inferior mesenteric artery. And rest other sites for paraganglioma, extra adrenal pheochromocyte paragangliomas are, sir, cervical, mediastinal region, pelvis, and retroperitoneum.
Okay.
And where in the bladder?
Bladder.
So which are usually non-functioning?
Which adrenal tumors are non-functioning? 10% are non-functioning.
10. Usually from neck and
thoracic.
If they are there from the parasympathetic, then they are non-functioning.
Okay, so
Ganesh, about any other adrenal tumor, can you ask them?
So if there is a, say, 5 cm myelolipoma on the right side, or what will you do? I mean, let's quickly discuss all these things, because we are nearing a better.
If it is asymptomatic to the patient, as it is 5 cm size, we can observe
for the patient. That is excellent. So when would you, in a small way, same question again, when would you decide to operate? Because as we all know, myelolipoma is the easiest adrenal surgery, fastest.
Sir, when there is a size of more than 6 cm, or then an episode of hemorrhage.
So size of 6 cm, Ashish, is also, myelolipoma is like 100% diagnostic.
Yes, sir. And sir, in pregnancy, patient is planning for pregnancy, we can... prior prophylactic adrenalectomy.
Patient planning for?
Female patient planning for pregnancy, sir.
Okay, I mean, I didn't know that actually.
They are rarely functioning. Functional also.
Symptomatic, we can do
that. Why in pregnancy?
Yeah.
Sir, there are more chances of getting hemorrhage into the adrenal, sir.
Myelolipoma.
In pregnancy.
In case of myelolipoma,
yes.
Angiomyolipoma, coldly myelolipoma.
Sir, angiomyolipoma.
So here discussion is going on only myelolipoma.
Okay.
You are mixing two things.
Okay, sir.
Adrenal myelolipoma and adrenal angiomyolipoma. These are two different things.
Okay.
And as far as pregnancy is concerned, which drugs to be given in first trimester, which drugs to be given in second trimester, what type of surgery in first time, second trimester, what type of surgery in third trimester, usually it is a phenoxybenzamine beta blocker and laparoscopy preferred in first 2 trimester. And in third trimester, LSCS, planned LSCS with excision of tumor is in third trimester.
Okay.
Sir, there's the question, sir. First trimester, do we go for, sir, surgery, or we can abort the patient, sir? Because usually in first trimester, it is quite risky, sir. You can go for abortion.
First time, first and second trimester, less than 24 weeks,
only second
penoxybenzamine plus beta blocker, and मुझे जितना पता है उतना first and second trimester है. आप कंफर्म कर लीजिए, गलत हो तो मुझे बता दीजिए, रेफरेंस देना पड़ेगा.
इंडिकेशन
फॉर अवर्स.
Okay, so preoperatively, if we are going to say a clinical diagnosis of and a radiological diagnosis of ACC, then how do you manage a case of say 7 centimeters?
Complete functional evaluation, like cortisol, so functional
evaluation on the course is normal.
Yes, sir.
It's normal.
It's not functional.
Non-functional. 7 centimeter big adrenal mass. So okay. CT quality is not like the adenoma. You do FDG PET.
If it is radiologically, radiologically appears to be ACC, sir, we can go for adrenalectomy, sir.
So no classic.
Radical adrenalectomy.
There is no absolute classic picture, like book picture, like this is ACC. So it has to be deduced finally. So what?
Sir, mass, adrenal mass more than 6 centimeter, we go for resection, sir.
Okay, resection.
If possible.
So any special care you will take?
If functional is functionality, though it is normal, we will go for sir alpha blockade and we'll prepare as a pheochromocytoma and then we go for resection.
Okay. So, say in the post-op, you will get a adrenocortical carcinoma and a, what is this WISE criteria?
It is actually pathological criteria for deciding malignancy. It includes 9 criteria, 9 to 10 criteria, including the nuclear grading and mitotic rate and atypical mitosis and cytoplasmic, and then invasion like capsular invasion, venous invasion, and totally more than 3 or equal to 3 criteria. If it is follows, then it is more likely to be malignant lesion.
Okay, so if it is 1 or 2, then it is
not in favor of malignancy.
So it is not in favor of malignancy. Perfect. Criteria score of more than 3 indicates an ACC, whereas the scores below 3, that is 0 to 2, define actually an adenoma kind of a thing.
Yes, sir.
And as the criteria increases, the, you know, whatever, the
prognosis.
Yeah, it worsens and the malignancy, I mean, index would increase probably.
Yes.
One of the questions which we had discussed, biopsy, role of biopsy. So that is like, there is a nice algorithm given in your Campbell's textbook of medicine for biopsy. The same points which we discussed, but it's in a form of algorithm. So coming to adrenal tumors, can anyone tell the staging? It's almost same like the...
Yes, sir.
Sir, if it is less than 5 centimeter, then it is E1.
Absolutely.
More than 5 centimeter, but no local invasion, that is T2. If it is locally invaded, T3, and metastatic is T4, sir. And in lymph nodes, N1 is regional lymphadenopathy, and M1 is metastatic.
Right. And basically, there are 2, UICC and NSAT. So that much you remember.
Yes, sir.
These are 2 classifications. NSAT is the European Network for Study of Adrenal Tumors. Okay.
Yes, sir. Okay.
So,
Hello, sir. Your voice.
Sir, your voice is breaking, sir.
Oh, sorry. My internet connection is bad. I was just asking any principles of surgery for an ACC.
It's a no touch technique and.
Touch to karna hi padega. I mean, whatever.
Yeah, but sir, so unnecessary.
Follow the same principle as in femoropneumocytoma, same sir. You go for resection along with the lymph node.
Most important is complete resection surgically, achieve R0, which is the strongest predictor of long term survival in ACC. So, if needed, O block resection is most important because ACC scan, you know. Matlab, even if you sometimes don't feel it is, having a good confined margin, it may not be. So wherever they are stuck, usually, and your diagnosis is ACC, en bloc resection of invaded organs, including if there is any lymph node, whatever, it is better to remove everything and achieve R0 completely.
Yeah.
So the problem with the laparoscopy in ACC would be there is a small chance of probably of peritoneal carcinomatosis, which may happen due to basically violation of the tumor capsule. And in that case, local recurrence and port site mets would happen in 30-40%. So very large ACCs also directly open adrenalectomy should be done, like more than 8-10 centimeters.
Yeah, that is given in the book. They say that it is contraindicated, laparoscopic surgery.
Laparoscopy is contraindicated. So if it's a few, you can, if it's a diagnostically few, you can still try laparoscopically. But if your clinical diagnosis is ACC, then it is best to not do laparoscopic surgery. So one question to you all, suppose if you're doing a laparoscopic procedure, what are the indications to open? I mean, you can tell anything you want, but generally...
Yes, we couldn't find the vein because of too much adhesions to renal upper pole or surrounding structure.
Yeah, so correct. Dense, unusual adhesions which can be there.
Bleeding because of neovascularization in case of large tumor.
Absolutely. Abnormal feeding retroperitoneal vessels which can be there. So large tumor sometimes, which you are attempting laparoscopy with little working space because yes. Adrenals are in such a place.
Yeah.
Sometimes a fiber tumor.
Yes.
So with regards to ACC, is there any role of any debulking?
Role of debulking is there, sir. But if we can resect more than 90% of tumor along with the locally invaded structures, if we could resect, then it gives progression-free survival more correct. Compared to the systemic. But overall survival will be it's not clear-cut, sir.
Okay. So what you said is kind of correct, but the same corollary is the reverse way around. Debulking should be done if you can remove at least 90% of the tumor. And especially in a secretory ACC, you know, that might be the intent.
Yes.
It helps in the chemotherapy, correct, Ganesh?
I mean, sometimes... Sir, it may be a very large size and it is secreting and causing other symptoms. So, it will help with respect to that.
Okay.
It might help in chemotherapy also. I mean, I agree to that. What is the role of radiation therapy?
Radiation therapy can be given
in high-risk patients.
High-risk patients.
We can give three. Adjuvant therapy. And in stage 3, we can give adjuvant therapy in the form of radiation.
In case of bone mets.
Yeah, so both these answers are correct. I mean, we don't treat ACCs primarily with radiation. Tumor responses may be less than 30%. And as you said, adjuvant radiation is given in pathologically higher Y-score ACCs with margins positive and other higher.
KI67 more than 10.
So data available is very less. but it has been used in the tumor bed to prevent so-called local recurrences. And again, as he said, radiation would be the treatment of choice for some of the metastatic sites. This is just to actually complete all the questions with respect to adrenal. Can you tell anything about mitotane?
Yeah.
I mean, earlier we never used to get it available. Nowadays, it is available. I mean, we can make it available.
It is used as a HU and chemotherapy agent, first line drug, in case of high risk or not R0 or R1 resection, or in it can be used in case of stage 4 progressive
unresectable.
Yes, sir, unresectable. It can be combined with multiple chemotherapeutic agents for progressive unresectable or stage 4 cancers. So basically DDT derivative, so okay. Cytotoxic cell effects.
More
and
information about that is necessary to be there. It is an expensive drug. What I was just talking a while back about ACCs post surgery, we do have, as even Ashish was saying, stage 1, 2 or 3. So 1 and 2 fall in the low intermediate risk. And important thing here is what my pathologist says sometimes, Ki-67. So Ki-67 less than 10% or rather higher than 10% is the highest.
Yes.
So what we are talking about, adjuvant treatment with either radiation or mitotane would be given in a R0 resected ACC, but with high risk features. So that would be the maximum we could do, or some can be done. Any follow-up protocols?
Follow-up,
sir. Every yearly metabolic functional evaluation is to be done, and along with CT scan for at least 4 years.
So in ACC, and it is 3 months for first 2 years.
Yeah, 3 monthly first 2 years.
So they are quite dangerous tumors, and recurrence rate as well as things can be very high.
Yes. 3 monthly, 2 years. Then after we can, previous scans were normal, then 6 monthly and then yearly also we can follow up further after 2 years.
So just to complete this, 5-year survival of stage 3 is around 25%, and stage 4 technically is less than 5% in spite of having mitotane and whatever other therapies.
Yes.
So how will you follow up incident?
Okay, please answer that.
Sir, incidental oma, sir, we will do the metabolic functional evaluation every yearly.
I think it is given less than 3 centimeter, more than 2 to 3 centimeter, correct? If it is less than 3 centimeter, it is not functioning and it is not improving in next 3 to 6 months. Usually there is no need to do much. But if it is more than 3 centimeter and it is increasing, then you have to do resection.
Yes.
Ganesh, what do you say about that? Dr. Jite?
Yes, sir.
Sorry, yeah. How was it?
The follow-up.
Follow-up of incidental oma.
Yeah, incidental oma.
Sir, what will happen is incidental oma is a term is when we actually diagnose a lesion in adrenal while doing some other investigation, and actually we'll take it ahead and characterize the tumor. Accordingly, we will treat it. So what remains back is an adenoma technically, or a very low featured So as we have already investigated these patients, if we are going to keep back an adenoma, which would be diagnosed with a washout, and some of the lesions which are non-functional, which are around less than 4 centimeters, and which are non-enhancing on any CT. So again, these are the features of having it a low malignant potential or something which is very similar to an adenoma. So only these are the tumors we'll observe. maybe 6 months, first year, we can do a CT scan. I mean, there is no written protocol, but that is what would do. We would see for the size, the change in size of the lesion, if it is growing or something. If it is going above the size criteria, then obviously we'll remove it. Gide sir is saying something.
As per the endocrine criteria, sir, it is the man followed up with non-contrast CT scan or MRI every 6 monthly or yearly, and watch for the increasing size of the tumor. If it is increasing rapidly or more than 4 centimeters, go for surgery.
Okay, now just tell us what is the difference between Cushing's disease and Cushing's syndrome. Mihir.
Cushing's disease is endogenous pituitary ACTH dependent tumor, and Cushing's syndrome includes all the exogenous steroid induced or endogenous ACTH dependent or independent causes leading to the high cortisol levels.
Non-dependent. ACTH is non-dependent. Correct.
Yes, sir. This is, sir.
Right.
It is non-dependent. So you are making
it. Hello, sir.
So it is ACTH non-dependent syndrome.
Dependent, sir.
Disease. What is the difference between disease and syndrome?
This is basically, sir, pituitary ACTH secreting tumor, sir.
Yeah, so it is dependent on, means there is excess of ACTH, correct?
Yes, sir.
And then what about syndrome?
Syndrome includes, sir, everything, sir. Including ectopic ACTH secreting tumor, including pituitary secreting ACTH tumor, including exogenous steroid induced.
Ganesh, can you just tell us? Or Dr. Gite?
The Cushing's, what he said is right. One is pituitary based, which is called Cushing's
disease.
And the syndrome is because of the local secretion from the adrenal.
Yeah, but though it is not ACTH dependent. Syndrome is usually not a dependent, no?
Sir, syndrome is a clinical symptoms because of hypersecretion of cortisol, sir. It covers endogenous as well as exogenous hypersecretion.
No, by definition, you just let me know. So in the group, you please forward it. Okay, read it and just forward.
Baki, I don't think much we have left actually, sir. Role of biopsy.
Only that, how will you prepare before operating for a Cushing's? How will you prepare? Like how you prepare for FIO? How will you prepare the patient? Mihir, what are the three important things you'll look after?
Sir, we'll supplement the cortisol day before perioperative cortisol supplementation may require. And along with that, same blood pressure monitoring and
you will control hypertension, you'll control diabetes, and you'll look after the muscle weakness. Because usually these patients will have a muscle weakness.
Yes,
so you have to treat all these three things.
Yes.
Okay, Ganesh, anything is left now?
Sir, actually, nothing is left. Matlab, ek basic sawal, what all is secreted from which layer of adrenal?
Yeah.
Sir, adrenal is divided into cortex and medulla. In cortex, sir, from glomerula, from glomerulosa, it secretes mineralocorticoids. From fasciculata, it secretes cortisols. And from reticularis, it secretes sex steroids. And from adula, it will be catecholamines.
Absolutely. Anything else is remaining, you only ask us. I mean, it's best to discuss now like that.
Yeah.
So the important thing in adrenal is how you locate an adrenal mass and how you evaluate
it. Sir, one question regarding FDG PET and they have written FDG PET versus MIBG. In Campbell, it's given that it meant to be if related PO is there, then FDG is more sensitive than MIBG and any other symptoms. It is not like that. So why it is like only specifically it's related to meant to be.
I'll ask an endocrinologist and put it on the group, honestly.
Yeah.
But moreover, FDG PET would be done when we suspect thing of a malignant nature. It helps us a lot. MIBG is very adrenal and FIO specific.
Yes,
sir. Sir, regarding pheochromocytoma's follow-up, do we follow up till sir lifelong follow-up, because there is a chances of sir recurrence in sir 16%.
So we do follow up these patients, and basically more than the surgeon, the endocrinologist always patients in a long-term follow-up.
Okay, sir.
So usually, gradually, they change the follow-up interval of this patient totally once the PO is out. And one more important thing which we missed actually, and we have been talking about this MEN2 and everything, is a family tree of the patient. Because we spoke about VHL, we spoke about MEN2, A, B, everything.
Yes, sir. And sir, regarding aldosteronoma, sir, if a patient has typical history and screening tools also suggest clear-cut aldosterone concentration and renin ratio, it suggests in favor of aldosteronoma, and even CT also showing one centimeter size of lesion in the only one normal one side of adrenal, then do we need to do confirmatory tests like saline load test? And
I think the endocrinologists do that.
Okay.
What our limitation comes is for mine actually, because we get a patient finally evaluated by them, but all these tests are done.
Okay. And lateralization, when we can skip, sir?
That the renin angiotensin, renin levels.
Sir. You are asking here, you are asking about what?
Lateralization in case of if we finally diagnose that there is a lesion in adrenal with confirmatory test of aldosteronism, then they do, sir, which side is actually...
If you have seen a lesion on for that particular side, the question of lateralization will come when you are not having a typical visible radiological lesion.
Okay, sir.
Okay, if you yourself is telling that there is a lesion.
But sir, they say, sir, adenoma also can be non-functional, sir. Whatever is.
Deco, classical features of adrenal aldosteronism or hyperaldosteronism and investigative support in terms of raised serum potassium, serum aldosterone, and aldosterone renin ratio, yes. And radiology. Everything is suggestive, and the need of lateralization, oblique renal vein renin on particular side or both sides. And then that has to be compared with opposite side. That is needed very well. Agar classical clinical features hai, radiological features hai, or investigative support hai, toh jaruri nahi.
Yes.
Theoretically, puch sakte, exam mein puch sakte ki kab renal vein renin karna hai, kab nahi karna hai. कैसा उसका रेशो बनाना या फिर किस में से क्या माइनस करना, थ्योरी है उसका तो थोड़ा पढ़ लो, लेकिन वो जो वहां तक यूजुअली पूछेंगे।
बराबर थिंक। और एनीथिंग एल्स इज रिमेनिंग गीते सर?
नहीं सर, मैंने वो इसका डिस्टेंस का भी वो डाला है सर ग्रुप।
हाँ,
क्या नाम होता है
एसीसी में
पुस्टिंग डिस्टेंस एंड पुस्टिंग सेंट्रो।
बराबर। तो सर
भी पिट्यूटरी सीक्रेट द कॉर्टिसोल एंड व्हेन द कॉर्टिसोल इज सीक्रेटेड बाय द अदर देन द पिट्यूटरी इन बाय स्टिमुलेशन ऑफ एक्टोपिकली प्रोड्यूस्ड एसीटीएस इन सच सिचुएशन इट इज कॉल्ड एज सेंट्रो and when it is related only to the pituitary it is called a disease. So disease is a part of syndrome.
So the definition which I had read was that it is independent of ACTH. The syndrome is independent of ACTH, means it is not dependent on that. Because if it is dependent on that, then it is directly from the pituitary, otherwise you cannot explain it.
Correct.
So logically also it doesn't make sense.
Usually, we are preparing for the exam. इतना detail minor level पे usually जाता नहीं है. Basic में राडा नहीं होना चाहिए.
Yeah, here it is written. I have read that Cushing syndrome arises from ACTH independent hyper secretion of cortisol from tumors of zona pesiculata of which half are benign and half are malignant. So it is independent.
I put on the chat box में डाला है.
Yeah. Okay. I think we have covered almost everything.
And one more question someone has asked, can adrenocortical carcinoma there is an increase in the normetanephrine? Answer to that also I have put in the chat box.
Usually Cushing disease is not a part of Cushing syndrome, sir. Because it's a part of sir Cushing syndrome, sir. Cushing disease is also part of Cushing syndrome, sir.
Okay, it is something new. In the Campbell, it is given. In the Campbell, it is given. You please put it onto our group.
Chat box में डाला है. Cushing disease is not the same as Cushing syndrome. Cushing syndrome
it's a small part of Cushing syndrome.
So that's what I'm telling. Na, why you are confusing and missing?
I think sir ने एकदम clearly डाला है, and that is correct.
Yeah.
तो मैंने मेरे दिल का नहीं डाला है, कोई बुक से निकाल के डाला है.
Okay.
Why you are getting confused on this? Another question asked in chat box is there any chance of having a adrenocortical carcinoma with raised nor metanephrine and metanephrine? That also I answered in the chat box. Usually it is not because the adrenocortical carcinoma is arising from the cortex and the pheochromocytoma is arising from the medulla. So both have different secretion. But sometimes adrenocortical carcinoma by its neuroendocrine function secretion, it will mimic like a pheochromocytoma and it is called as a pseudopheochromocytoma. In such particular situation, there is a chance of having sometimes raised or metanephrine or metanephrine. And the literature on this is very rare. That is also put in the chat box. So, agar aisa nahi hi ho sakta, aisa koi reason nahi ho sakta. And it cases are reported.
Okay. I think we have
any doubt agar kuch hai to puch.
So, Doctor, we have given you answer almost everything. I think we should stop here now.
Sir, kaisa hai? Kuch cheez humko bhi pata nahi rehti. Aisa nahi ki everything we know.
Yeah,
yeah. Kabhi kuch dekh ke bhi bata sakte hai. Aisa koi necessity.
Yeah, and that is the reason we have got our group. So if anything is there, we can put it on.
Because our discussion and class is made for only such type of teaching. So it is bioethics. Everything, हमको पता रहना जरूरी नहीं है. कुछ चीजें पता नहीं भी रही. तो book में देख के भी बता.
And some part of the adrenal is linked very closely with the endocrine related workup. I mean, we all should know when we come to a theory related thing in exam. But अभी तो एक थ्योरी का लेक्चर सर गौरांग सर अरेंज कर लें, ऐसा कुछ नहीं.
लास्ट ईयर किए थे सर अपन नलिनी शर्मा मैडम का, इस टाइम पे भी करना
है. अनफॉर्चूनेटली वी कुड नॉट हिट रिकॉर्डिंग.
यस सर,
पॉसिबल वी विल रिपीट अगेन, नो प्रॉब्लम.
ओके
देन, चलो थैंक यू वेरी मच.